فعاش القلب إخلاصا وصرت تحومك الطير تحلق في ثقافات وتنهل من ربى الخير.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، حمدا كثيرا طيبا مباركا فيه، وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه ومن تبعهم بإحسان الى يوم الدين. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Brothers and sisters, we've reached the final segment of our Straight Path Convention 2015 in Makanista, Malaysia, the land of milk and honey. So alhamdulillah, we've had a very good response for the Q&A sessions. So inshallah, while we wait for the brothers to just complete up the setup, you can check your WhatsApp just in case your wifey has just sent you some messages, so you can prevent any potential warfare as the Sheikh mentioned. You can also check, let's have a show of hands. How many of you actually shared some knowledge from this convention and put hashtag straight path? Let's see the hands. MashaAllah. I'm also putting mine up. I just submitted one half an hour ago. MashaAllah. Very good. Very good. That's an increment of about 800%. MashaAllah. So let's keep it up. You still have, you've taken notes throughout the entire 2 days. So you can keep them up, keep them running. That hashtag, let's keep it active even throughout the weeks to come. You can come visit it. You can see some notes, any transcripts that anyone has had the diligence of sharing with the others. Inshallah, let's make this a form of ajr that can continuously go on. And let's just say that this is some waiting time so that while the DVD is being produced, inshallah, this is something that inshallah the people can benefit from. Okay, so for that, we'd like to invite the shuyukh on stage for the Q&A session. Fatafaddalu. So alhamdulillah, by the end of just before Asr, we had about 240 questions. So it was an overwhelming response. And that was actually after we filtered out all the requests to take photographs with the shuyukh. And it was actually there. Scissor, paper, stones, Sheikh. Okay. All right, mashallah. Okay, we'll be doing the same format just as yesterday, inshallah. So these questions have been prioritized in the order that the committee felt that this would benefit the people the most, and perhaps more pressing questions that inshallah we feel are having more urgency to be addressed. And we apologize in advance if your question has not been able to address within this session, inshallah. Okay, the first question we have. This is for Sheikh Muhammad Salah. Salam, I've got a question that I deem important. To someone who is educated and trained to think logically, sometimes they find it hard to pray or commit any acts of worship because they think Allah will forgive them anyway. To these people, is there any hope for them to enter Jannah?
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Shaddad ibn Aws radiyallahu anhu narrated, and the hadith is collected by Imam al-Tirmidhi, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, الكيس من دان نفسه وعمل لما بعد الموت. The wise person is the one who takes himself into account and prepares for what is after death. والعاجز من أتبع نفسه هواها. The person who is foolish and such a failure is the one who subdues himself into his desire and whims. Meanwhile, he hopes that Allah the Almighty will fulfill his vain desires. So he doesn't do anything and he hopes to enter paradise. He does not fulfill what Allah has ordained upon him. And he expects that he will be with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in Al-Firdaus Al-A'la. Let me share this with you quickly. When the great companion Rabi'a ibn Ka'b al-Aslami, may Allah be pleased with him, who used to serve the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and pour the water of his wudu, especially during the night for him. So one day the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam wanted to reward him, and he said, Ya Rabi'ah, ask of me. Ask of anything. So he thought about it and he said, Ya Rasulullah, as'aluka murafaqataka fil jannah. I want to be with you in paradise. I want to be with you. That sounds like a song. I want to be with you in paradise. This is what he said, not just to enter heaven, but to be with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said, "Aw ghayra dhalika ya Rabi'a?" Don't you have any other request other than that? He said, "That's it. You ask me, and this is what I long for." He said, "Ya Rabi'a." He did not tell him, "Okay, inshallah, you will be with me in paradise." But rather he said, "Idhan fa'a'inni 'ala nafsika bikathrati as-sujud." Ya Rabi'a, help me out to achieve this goal by doing much of sujood. Of course, you don't do sujood on its own. What a sajda or any unit of the prayer refers to the prayer. We can call it tasbiha, we call it rak'a, we call it sajda. Yani, Ya Rabi'a, if you want to be with me in paradise, not only that you should offer the fard, but also you should compete with regards to the nawafil. A'inni ala nafsika bikathrati as-sujood. It is not for free. أَلَا إِنَّ سِلْعَةَ اللَّهِ غَالِيَةٌ أَلَا إِنَّ سِلْعَةَ اللَّهِ الْجَنَّةِ. Indeed, the commodity of Allah is very precious. It is very expensive. That is al-jannah. And as I say, there is not a single ayah in the Quran that promises the believers that they shall enter paradise without saying الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ. In more than 60 positions in the Quran. So you cannot say I'm a mu'min without fulfilling what Allah has ordained upon you. The least is to fulfill the fard. When this man came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and said, "Ya Rasulullah, teach me what Allah has ordained upon me." He said, 5 daily prayers. Illa an tatawwa. Unless if you want to offer extra. Similarly, the sadaqah, the hajj, the fasting, he told him about the fard. So he said, "Ya Rasulullah, walladhi ba'athaka bilhaq, I swear to the one who sent you with the truth, I shall not do anything extra nor less. La azidu ala hada wala anqus." So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when this guy turned around, he said, "Whoever likes to see somebody who will be among the dwellers of heaven, look at this man. If he can just stick to fulfilling the fard, but without any deficiency, without any drawbacks." So if there is drawbacks, then we have to make it up through offering and nawafil. Don't you think that you're going to enter paradise without praying? Husnul dhan requires that you fulfill your part of the equation so that the equation will be balanced and Allah the Almighty will deliver. Seek forgiveness for the past and begin right now. Make a new promise that you will not miss a single prayer. Imagine when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, أول ما يسأل عنه العبد يوم القيامة الصلاة. The very, very first question that you will be asked about is a prayer. فإذا صلحت صلح سائر عمله. If the person had offered his prayer properly and it was done upright, then the rest of his deeds will be upright. وإذا فسدت فسد سائر عمله. If he was ruined, then the rest of his deeds will be ruined. May Allah save us all.
Ameen. Jazakallah khair, Sheikh Muhammad Salah. Our second question is from a sister. This is for Sheikh Ismail Mank. Assalam. Dear Mufti Mank, I've been married for nearly 13 years. My marriage life is not easy and I do not understand it, and I understand it's a test from Allah. I'm trying with patience. I always forgive people and I would always make excuses. However, my husband hates this. He prays and not at all, but he prays and everything. However, his relationship with other people is very bad. He tells me that I will not enter Jannah as he is not pleased with me and in his eyes. So it's as if he is threatening her with by disobeying him that she may not enter Jannah. And I'm a failure as a wife. All lectures, local or international, have said that wives have to obey husband, which I am trying and it's very difficult. I have children and I'm educating Islam in them. I find it very difficult. What is your advice for me, Sheikh?
Bismillah ar-Rahman. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. I think the sister needs to bear patience by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and continue to try and try her best. Remember, obedience for anyone in the disobedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not applicable. So you have to obey your husband, yes, correct, but you don't obey him where he is wrong, where he is unreasonable, where he is asking you to do something in the disobedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if he does have bad habits or bad relations with people and you have a good relation with people, perhaps you would like to speak to him once in a while. I know you say you were married for 30 years, which is not easy to change a person after 30 years, but with dua and with a trial, a beautiful trial, by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you will be able to achieve. I just want to put into, put everyone into perspective here that we who are married, and I'm sure a lot of us here are probably married, may Allah grant spouses to those who are not married as well. Ameen. Oh, he says, and those who are married as well. Okay, inshallah. If that's applicable in your situation, alhamdulillah. Oh, mashallah. See, Sheikh Abdul Rahim told us a joke. Maybe he wants to repeat it for us a little bit later. No. You need to say it again. There are people who don't know. Inshallah, we'll get to you, Sheikh. So, they say those who talk about it do not do it. So when your husband talks about it, don't worry, he won't do it. I hope you heard what I said, mashallah. So, getting back to what we were saying is, every marriage has to have some degree of sacrifice, challenge, obstacle. There has to be. You will never ever have 100% compatibility except in Jannah with the same person. Subhanallah. That's when you get 100% compatibility, so much so that you're just thinking of something and they're thinking of the same thing and you're like, wow. It can happen with a lot of people. I think the maximum maybe that I have seen is perhaps about 90% compatibility. Alhamdulillah. But the truth is, you have to have challenges so that you can appreciate Jannah. You can appreciate what Allah has kept for you. So don't think, oh my husband, everyone has to complain. If everyone were to complain, we'd all draw up a list. You know, I heard one sheikh recently speaking about an issue where people were complaining to one wise man. And so the wise man says, okay, every one of you, write down your 10 of your major problems in your life. So they all wrote it and they brought it and they put it here. So in the next gathering, he tells them, right, each one of you come here and pick out a set of problems that you are happy with. Pick out a set of problems that you are happy with. So he says, the people came and now the problems are jumbled up. You have to have some test in your life, don't you? Allah says he's going to test you. You need to have some set of problems, don't you? So he says, as the people came, they picked the first paper and quickly put it down because there were big problems in there. Pick the second one, quickly put it down. Pick the third one. When they picked a few, they said, no, we want our paper back. So people say, we want our own paper back, which means Allah knows your capacity. He's given you issues and tests which happen to be upon a capacity that you can handle. And that's your paradise. But yes, if some oppression is happening to the degree that is unacceptable and it's continuous, you are allowed to seek termination of that marriage. You know, divorce is something very permissible in Islam, but it's frowned upon if it's done for nothing, if it's done without trying. If it's done without actually trying to mend, then it's frowned upon. But if it's done as a last resort, by all means, it's actually a means of getting closer to Allah because your stress would be less. Sometimes people are married and they're in such a difficult condition. Allah does not doom you to say, stay in that condition forever. But he says, look, try, make it work. If you really cannot, then alhamdulillah, you can seek a dissolution of that particular situation. However, getting back to the issue, try your best. It's been so many years. We've got a few years remaining of our lives. We try our best to maintain. It doesn't seem like it's such a major issue. Sometimes we make small issues appear to be so big because we constantly complain about them and so on. I'd like to think that the sister is only asking for guidance. So these are the few words of guidance. I mean, you would never hear from me to say, sister, you have a problem, break your marriage and carry on. That's wrong. That's not advice. And the reason why I say this is our friends tell that to us. Sometimes we have a small marital issue. You know, my husband, he swore me today. Oh, that's it. If I were you, I'd go home. But you've been sworn 20 times and you haven't gone home. Why did you give your friend the wrong advice? That's the thing. Why do you want to see them being divorced and sitting sad? Give them advice. Look, you know, the men, they do that. Address the situation. Talk to him. Write him a note. You know, maybe tell him how much you love him. You know, do a few romantic things. That's your husband at the end of the day. And, you know, how many of us have actually had a rose that we've put under the pillow for them to just look at and smile? A few, perhaps very few. But then we want to complain that, you know, our marriage lacks romance and so on. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the ability to work on our marriages and to appreciate the set of tests that we will have within the same marriage. Jazakumullah khair.
Ameen. Okay, our next question is for Sheikh Abdul Rahim Green. Yesterday he started a sunnah of passing microphones, so...
No, actually, he wanted me to sit there, and I couldn't sit there because I wanted the fan, but I tried to be humble and tell him, Sheikh, go to the center, you know. And then when I sat here, the microphone I had didn't work, so he wanted to run away from the questions, and this is the microphone that works. But haqqan, I've got 2,500, 3,500 witnesses and so many online who know that this microphone belongs to him, so there you go.
MashaAllah. Okay, the question is, Sheikh, you've mentioned that da'wah is not necessarily in charity, good akhlaq, in smiles. So what are some easy methods of da'wah that you can recommend that we can get a kickstart? I'm very shy lah. That was from me. People are shy.
No, I'm not. I wasn't. Don't misunderstand me. And I wasn't saying those things do not constitute dawah and they cannot be part of dawah. But my emphasis is primarily when you read the Quran and you look at the stories of the prophets, you find that the dawah of the prophets is there talking and discussing with people. It's through speech. Of course, their example matched their speech. But they were not content with walking around just being nice people. They engaged people in discussions, in intellectual arguments, in the best way to convince people that what they were believing was wrong and that what they had bought was the truth. So, it's too big a topic really to discuss the details of how we can give dawah, but very simply, brothers and sisters, it's very simple. The important principle to realize is you should always go back to the fundamentals. So part of the problem often we have when on the issue of dawah, I mean especially to non-Muslims, is we can get carried away discussing things that are very subsidiary. So you may have a long discussion on hijab, or you know, maybe with Chinese people, a lot of them love to eat pork. So you'll have a long, long discussion about pork and it has this disease and that disease. And it's a very, very weak form of discussion. Even from an intellectual angle, it's very weak. I'll tell you why. Say, for example, just for the sake of argument, I said, okay, so we can now breed a pig that is completely free of disease, and I can prove to you scientifically, not only is it free of disease, but actually we've designed the pig in a special way that it can retain antibiotics and vitamins to make you better. Is it halal? No. So why is pig haram? Well, everyone, I know you know the answer, Sheikh. They're all looking at me like, I thought that was the reason it was haram. The reason it's haram, as the Sheikh said, is because Allah said it's haram. So this is what everything goes back to. Yes, of course we believe there is a reason and a wisdom for everything. But the bottom line is, brothers and sisters, you know, we do something because Allah has told us to do it. We leave something because Allah has told us to leave it. So we need to go back to the basics. We need to make people who are not Muslim, and by the way, many Muslims need to understand this principle. The principle is that we worship Allah and we obey Allah. So we need to convince people that Allah is the one that we should obey and He is the one who we should worship alone. And that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam is His prophet and that we should follow Him. So this is the methodology of dawah that we teach. So rather than going into the details of that, you could, for example, go to a website called Mission Dawah, I think missiondawah.com, and you will find some videos discussing this method and how to bring people back to the conversation about Allah, the oneness of Allah, revelation, prophethood, and this is the foundation of our dawah. Even, by the way, to many Muslims, they need to hear this as well. So that's really what I would say, rather than going into all the details, which is, I don't have time, go and inshallah, look there, you'll find some good guidance on that, inshallah.
Inshallah. Okay, our next question is for Sheikh Ismail Menk. This is about social media. How should we as people of Jannah react when our brothers and sisters in Islam commit bad acts and they go viral in the social media? Is it right to be judgmental?
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. I'm going to answer you by telling you what I would do and what I have done. If you know how social media works, there is very little that you can actually do about what goes viral and what people put up. They put it up, they're free to put it up. If you block them, for example, sometimes you might not see what they've said, but other people will see it. So I would, if it's something really bad, I would block the person, for example, so that I don't need to see what's happening. And at the same time, I would increase my good work. So if I put a tweet a day, I'll put 4 tweets a day, 5 tweets a day, something really good. And, you know, we try and flood the social media with that which is brilliant, so it eclipses that which is not. Unfortunately, it's the other way around today, where what's bad is eclipsing what's good. So if we can, you know, for those of you who might know a little bit about how Twitter works, for example, you have these hashtags that start trending. And sometimes I've been watching how we can, as Muslimin, create a trend by, you know, flooding Twitter with something great. But don't be foolish in the way you say things, because you need to remember it's such a big platform of da'wah, not just for Muslims, but even for non-Muslims and even for the enemies. This afternoon I had an interview with one of the stations, and they were asking me about what's my dream in a nutshell with all this da'wah. And I said, look, that what I would like to achieve, obviously there are so many things, but one very important point that I always think about is those who hate Islam so much, the minimum that I would like to see them getting to is the realization that Islam is not a bad religion. That's all. So if I can do that, and if Allah has used me to do that, we've actually dropped down the enmity of the enemy, which is a big success. And how is that going to happen? By living Islam, by talking Islam, by showing that Islam is actually a beautiful faith. So on social media, there are so many dirty things that go viral, and some of us retweet it and repost it and share it, and it's dirty, it's bad, it's unacceptable. If you take a look at the amount of sharing that goes on of dirty songs of people, and you know, the fashion world and nudity and so much, it is in the millions. To be honest with you, 100,000, 500,000. You look at YouTube, the number 2 million in 3 days, 5 million. And guess how many Muslims are there? It's difficult for us to say, but I'm telling you a big percentage of that will also be Muslimin. Because sometimes you, out of your inquisitive nature, wants to say, okay, let me just see what's going on. So you see, to be honest, you go and look at the bad and you want to look at more bad. Just say astaghfirullah and set it aside, delete it, or perhaps unfollow. Another very interesting point I'd like to raise, and I don't pry on anyone. To be honest with you, I don't even have the time. But sometimes for interest and in order to learn, you see a few Muslims and you say, okay, let's see what type of people these people follow, or these people, you know, like. So now you go back to their Facebook page, a random person on the globe, and do it. See what happens and tell yourself, is this the condition of the Muslim Ummah? When you see, for example, out of the 500 people we're following, those who might give you religious messages are just 2 or 3. The rest of them are Justin Bieber, and someone told me he's a Yemeni. His name is actually Babair. I said, no ways, it's not correct, not at all. And then someone else comes up with some other person, and I don't know the other names. There is a very, very famous woman, Perry, if I'm not mistaken, Katy Perry, that's the name. And the Muslims are the ones who actually, wow, this is good and that's good. Come on, relax. This is going to go down in your book of deeds forever and ever. You'd rather just say, look, unfollow, done. Not because we hate and we this, but it's just because we want to follow a good example. That's it. And don't be shy to say, okay, someone looks at your timeline and they see, okay, there's only people who are calling towards goodness. What's wrong with that? Nothing at all. Don't be shy. So I hope these are just a few guidelines, and I've spoken to you from what I would do myself. flood it with good so that the bad is eclipsed. Wallahu a'lam.
Wallahu a'lam. Jazakallah khair. We were just discussing with the brothers, Sheikh, that it's a sunnah of Allah that sahih hadith is rarely going viral. It's very rare that sahih hadith actually...
Can I add something? Okay. Today I want to say something that I've never said before in public. When I started some time back, and it was just a coincidence, there's a whole history of why I was on Facebook and how I was on Twitter and so on. I'm not going to get into that. But I used to quote a verse of the Quran, and I used to get people who used to say things. And sometimes you have a verse or a hadith, and sometimes you know there is 140 characters. You've got to get a message through in that many characters on Twitter. So I noticed, wallahi, and Allah is my witness, that there were people who used to swear sometimes the message that comes from the Quran, disagree with it, and they would find fault with it, and they are Muslims. And I felt it so bad. I had nightmares, and I said, no ways, I can't do this. I'd rather it be a verse translated in my own language, so if in my own little wording, so if someone disagrees with it, at least they don't arrive at kufr. Because to disagree with the verse of the Quran, it removes you from the fold of Islam. That's it. If you say, oh, this is wrong, I disagree with it, I can't. I will cry because I was the one who put the verse up. So because I saw this, and because I saw the impact of it, and I said, if they disagree with what I say, perhaps there is something called ta'wil. You know, you might be able to say, okay, this person doesn't know, they did this, they did that. So this is when I took the verses or the ahadith and translated it into normal, simple English and then pushed it up. That's why I do it this way. People say, why don't you quote the hadith? Why don't you quote... Wallahi, whenever I've put in, sometimes I do put in a hadith, you find that the number of people who are interested in it is very, very, very small. But the minute it's not a hadith, or it is a hadith worded in different language, for example, and you don't say it's a hadith, wow, the world is like, subhanallah, but where did you get it from? Islam. It's actually a Muslim quote. So we do have a sickness, I agree. You know, my wife always tells me, just look at it. You put in a verse of the Quran and check what happens. Nobody's interested. But put a quotation of Albert Einstein and the world goes, wow. So why? Where are we? Why are we shy? Are we shy to acknowledge it's a verse of the Quran? Well then, how are we going to enter Jannah and you walk on the straight path? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us break these barriers. Jazakallah khair.
Ameen. Jazakallah khair. Very good advice, Sheikh. Okay, our next question is for Sheikh Muhammad Salah. Assalamu alaikum. If we were negligent on doing salah when we were young and now we want to change for the better and we want to start praying, how is the best way to repent? Do we need to replace all the years of missing salawat?
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. It is my tradition whenever I answer questions like that, which have two major schools, to present the different opinions, not to limit my answer to one view. So the vast majority of the fuqaha are of the view that you should still make it up in a way that you count how many years and multiplied by how many prayers, and accordingly, since you repented, you start making up the missed prayers. Along with each prayer, you pray as many prayers as possible. Like you prayed Fajr this morning, so you pray another Fajr and another Fajr, another Fajr, and you have a chart and you start counting down how many prayers you made up. While according to Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah and his student Ibn al-Qayyim and many others, there is a view that says if a person does not pray and does not pray for years, he has actually been removed from the folds of Islam. And that is relied on sound hadith. Take for instance that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in the sound hadith, العهد الذي بيننا وبينهم الصلاة فَمَنْ تَرَكَهَا فَقَدْ كَفَرٌ. That barrier distinguishes between Muslims and non-Muslims is a prayer, as far as the acts of worship. And the same thing, that barrier is not as powerful as with the rest of the ibadat, only in the case of the salah. So if somebody does not pray, whether out of negligence, you know, out of laziness, you name it, and he does not pray at all, then this person is pronounced as a kafir or a non-Muslim. Accordingly, if the person repented, realized that he was in great error, and he repented, that means he accepted Islam after he was in a state of kufr, which means he's not due to make up something that was due whenever he was in a state of kufr. And they advised him in a state, in order for his tawbah to be accepted, to augment the number of rak'ahs of nawafil, to pray the emphatic sunan, as we said, 4 rak'ahs before dhuhr, 2 rak'ahs after dhuhr, 2 after maghrib, 2 after isha, 2 before fajr. In addition to the non-emphatic, the night prayer, the duha prayer, the witr prayer, and so on and so forth. So this is their view. If the person was definitely not praying for years, and it will be extremely difficult for him to count how many prayers he's missed, he can as well repent, seek forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, be consistent on the prayer from the moment that he repented, and try his best to do as much nawafil as possible. You know, this morning, as we went to offer the Fajr prayer, I swear to Allah, I felt myself in heaven. And when the Adhan finished, especially in Masjid Salahuddin, what a beautiful masjid, and what a beautiful gathering and recitation. I swear to Allah, before, subhanAllah, before I say Allahu Akbar to pray rak'atay al-fajr, the sunnah before fajr, this hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam crossed my mind, in which he said, rak'ata al-fajri khayrun min ad-dunya wa ma fiha. The whole world has become beneath my feet. There is no temptation in this world when it comes to comparing the whole world to 2 rak'ahs that you offer before fajr. The 2 rak'ahs, the sunnah before fajr, are far, way better than the whole dunya and what it contains. This is what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said. Imagine this is the sunnah. So what about the fard? What about praying fajr in jama'ah? Inna Qur'an al-fajr kana mashhuda. The 2 shifts of the angels attend the fajr prayer. They enjoy the recitation of the imam, while Muslims are negligent of the prayer. They may pray it past sunrise, they may not pray it at all. And some people ask, can I just pray the 5 daily prayers by the end of the day, all at once? And wallahi, do not think it's strange. I get some questions, that can I pray them all early morning at once? Things like that. Whenever we speak about the salah, brothers and sisters, we should not only look at it from the angle of it's a duty that we have to offer. A salah is a silah, is a connection. You know, how much time can you last not on a standby while you're using your smartphone? How much time can the battery last? 2 hours, 3 hours of constant use? Then afterward, what do you need to do? Recharge it. Nowadays, you carry the power source and the charger with you wherever you go, right? Because you are constantly in need for your smart device. Your heart is like the battery, needs to be recharged on a regular basis. Subhanallah, one visit you pay to the mall or a shopping center, you earn thousands and thousands of sayyat. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, وَأَتْبِعِ السَّيِّئَةَ الْحَسَنَةَ تَمْحُهَا. Follow the evil deed with one which is good, it shall erase it. Like what, ya Rasulullah? This man entered the masjid upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he was crying, he was in tears, and said, ya Rasulullah, طَهِّرْنِي, purify me. This guy used to have a girlfriend before Islam. While he was coming to the masjid, she met him. Hey, how are you? What's up? Miss you, man. So he ended up giving her a kiss and a hug. Then he realized, what did I just do? I'm a Muslim. I'm not supposed to do that. So he came running. He thought he's supposed to be purified and punished like ma'iz, haddu zina, huh? Maybe lashed or even a stone. He said, ya Rasulullah, I've committed a big sin. Tahirni. He said, what did he do? So he told him, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam does not have in the constitution a punishment set for kissing or touching a woman. No, the punishment is for actual adultery. So he kept quiet. Then while the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was sitting in his masjid, Jibreel alayhi salam came down with an ayah of Surah Hud. أقم الصلاة طرفي النهار وزلفا من الليل إن الحسنات يذهبن السيئات ذلك ذكرى للذاكرين. Establish the prayer both طرفي النهار وزلفا من الليل, the morning and in the evening. Why? Because the good deeds erase the bad deeds. So the Prophet ﷺ said, where is the questioner? Where is the guy who just asked me about, you know, the hadd and the punishment, who wanted to be purified? They said, he's there. Call him. He said, have you prayed Asr with us in Jama'ah? He said, yes, I did. He said, your sin have been forgiven. Umar ibn al-Khattab said, Ya Rasulullah, he heard the whole scenario, the question, the pause, and the wahi sent down to answer this guy. He said, Ya Rasulullah, أَهِيَ لَهُ خَاصَّةٌ أَمْ لِلنَّاسِ كَافَةٌ. Is this ayah, has this ayah been revealed to answer his question only, an exclusive case, a special condition? Or is it general for the entire ummah that whenever you commit sins, then you attend the prayer, especially in jama'ah, the sins will be removed? He said, بَلْ هِيَ لِلنَّاسِ كَافَةً. Rather, it is for the entire ummah. زَادَ خَيْرُ اللَّهِ وَكَثُرُ. Allah loves us to be forgiven. Allah wants us to enter heaven. So he says, الصَّلَوَاتُ الْخَمْسِ وَالْجُمُعَةُ إِلَى الْجُمُعَةِ ورمضان إلى رمضان مكفرات لما بينهن مجتنبة الكبائر. Offering the five daily prayers on a regular basis is an exception for whatever sins were committed in between. Who can afford to miss such a great opportunity for his sins to be forgiven? Even if the salah is not fard, is not mandatory, rather if you pray it, your sins will be forgiven. It should be more than enough. You take one step towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah takes a long distance towards you, a mile distance towards you. What we need to understand, brothers and sisters, is to change our tradition, the concept of looking into the ibadat as just duties. Rather, we need to learn how to enjoy it. How once we start the salah, we say Allahu Akbar, you're disconnected. You're disconnected from the whole world, because you are currently connected to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
JazakAllah khair, Shaykh Muhammad Salah. Okay, for our next one. Assalamu alaikum, brothers. I am an Australian sister converted to Islam since the year 1997. I don't have a question, but I want to take the opportunity to ask if you could mention my family, especially my mother, in everyone's dua that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will open their hearts to Islam and make them amongst the rightly guided. May Allah make you steadfast, sister, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide your family, especially your mother, to Islam, and may Allah make your family amongst the rightly guided. Amen. Okay. Sorry, just give me a second. Inshallah. Okay, this is for Sheikh Ismail Menk. Assalamu alaikum. My question is for our beloved brother Mufti. Our animals are going to enter Jannah without hisab or judgment. I once read a Quranic ayah which says all animals would be entering Jannah without my hisab, but I forgot which ayah. Just for your info, Sheikh, the one who asked this is a cat lover, so his concern is... So their primary concern is they love their cats very much and they want to spend time in Jannah together with them.
Jazakumullah khair. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. I've been asked this question so many times, will my cat be in Jannah? And one simple answer is yes. Only if you still think of your cat when you are in Jannah, and you won't. That's what I'm saying. So the answer is no. Like what I explained a little bit earlier, something quite clear that, you know, people become depressed just by the thought that my cat is not going to be with me and I love my cat. The truth is, Don't think about what you're going to get in Jannah with the brain that you have now and lose focus upon entering paradise. Concentrate on the fact that when I get to paradise, I will have whatever I wish at that point. But from now, if I wish for something, I may not think of it there. Like yesterday, I gave an example. I find it's a very, very relevant example. The one about the time and how time makes you dislike something that you liked some time back. You know, you dream of having an iPhone 7. But by the time you get it, if it's already 2040 and there's an iPhone 20, which I think will look like that, subhanAllah, then you won't want this little thing here anymore, because your dreams keep on changing, because this is dunya. It keeps on, you know, changing and so on. When you see what Allah has kept for you in Jannah, I don't even think you're going to think of a lot of the stuff that you thought of in the dunya, and you won't even want it. So I don't want to sadden you, but I'd like to tell you that, you know, when it comes to the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he speaks of the animals and how the two sheep or goats that had battled in the dunya will be given a chance to seek justice. The one who didn't have horns will be given horns in order to seek justice, in order to compensate whatever has happened, you know. And after that, they will all be destroyed by the will of Allah, meaning they will be, their purpose of creation will come to an end, basically. Wallahu a'lam, Allah knows best. Sheikh Muhammad, you want to add to that, inshallah? Bas, barakallah fi. I was just making sure they're not going to be cats there, inshallah.
Jazakallah khair, Sheikh. For our next question, is for Sheikh Abdurrahim Green. Assalamu alaikum. I want to go to Jannah with my wife, who is a newly converted Muslim. Finally, somebody wants to go to Jannah with his wife. That's what Sheikh said.
I do too, ya akhi, mashallah.
Me too, inshallah. Because she's here. But unfortunately, my wife refuses to do the 5 daily prayers. She keeps on saying that there is no compulsion in Islam. She will do it when she is ready. She said, the more I try to guide her, the more we argue. Now I'm afraid that the gap of our iman gets bigger and Jannah gets further apart from between us. Nevertheless, our love for each other is not affected. My wife is a perfect wife for me, for I cannot find any flaws except her duty to Allah as a Muslim.
Sheikh Mufti Menk.
Subhanallah. Sheikh Muhammad Salah.
Don't Sheikh Faisal me.
I think I just answered the question earlier. I did. The question was answered earlier, alhamdulillah, about the importance of the prayer and what if you do not pray. And subhanallah, there is one hadith, Sheikh Mufti Ismail, where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, كل أمتي يدخلون الجنة. Rejoice. Every member of my ummah shall enter paradise. كل أمتي يدخلون الجنة. Behold, إلا من أبى. Except for him who refuses. The companions were shocked. And who would refuse to enter paradise? He said, من أطاعني دخل الجنة. ومن عصاني فقد أبى. Whoever obeys me shall enter paradise. And whoever disobeys me has refused to enter paradise. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide the sister and every brother and sister who's lacking behind on their prayer. This is the only act of worship which, if you are truly negligent of its performance, can lead you out of the folds of Islam. And if you die in this condition, just imagine the first su'al, the first question will be, have you prayed? You better prepare an answer for this question.
JazakAllah khair, Sheikh. Very, very straight to the point, mashallah. Okay, our next question is for Sheikh Muhammad Salah. Oh, okay.
It's okay.
Okay, we'll switch that to Sheikh Ismail, inshallah. My question is, I'm working in a conventional bank in Malaysia. I am dealing with riba transactions every day. I've been looking for other jobs since a few years back, including lecturing, and went for a few interviews, so on and so forth. Unfortunately, no response, have few financial commitments, so on. Should I just quit my job and put my trust in Allah, knowing that I'm dealing with haram?
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. I think you need to look for another job inshallah, and then once you have another job inshallah you'll be able to you know, quit the job that you're in. If you are dealing directly in the promotion of interest and so on, then I would suggest you get, you shift departments. So there are levels of it. I children all on the street and everything happening. So it will, it, what you can do is, if you are directly involved in the interest factors, you can get shift of department to shift into a department that does not directly deal with it, which would be slightly better. And thereafter, inshallah, you perhaps would like to look for a job and continue looking, call out to Allah, ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to open the doors. When you get a job that inshallah would be out of any murky waters, inshallah you will proceed to that. For now, I do not suggest that you just quit your job and just go onto the street. Wallahu a'lam. Allah knows best.
So, Sheikh Muhammad, can I ask you a question now? Oh, okay. It's his turn. Okay. Okay, this is for Sheikh Abdurrahim Green. Assalamu alaikum. I'm 16. MashaAllah. My question is about sharing these messages of Islam. Is it really wajib? Really, really, really wajib? Wallahi, this is, she said it three times. How can I share these messages if I'm a delinquent myself at school and I may not even follow the facts and knowledges that I will share to my friends?
Well, the nature of the obligation depends upon your circumstance. Yeah. So the way I explain it is that if you are a shepherd in the Atlas Mountains in Morocco and you don't see a non-Muslim, in fact even your great-grandmother never saw a non-Muslim, yeah, the obligation of dawah upon you is very, very small, maybe it's non-existent. But if you are in a school and half of the people in your school are non-Muslims, then the obligation of dawah upon you is very, very, very high. And therefore, you have to learn how to explain Islam to people who are non-Muslim. And it definitely is an obligation upon you. And if you don't have the knowledge to do it, then getting the knowledge becomes an obligation upon you. Because whatever is an, whatever helps you to fulfill an obligation itself is an obligation. Yeah? So yes, it is wajib, however many times you said it, and even more than that, yeah? And to get the knowledge and to learn how to talk to people about Islam is something you have to do, and Allah knows best.
Okay, jazakallah khair, Sheikh. I think it's worth pointing out this question came from somebody who's 16 years old and already concerned about giving da'wah. So we make a dua to Allah that she's steadfast.
Yeah, I think my son was like 14 when he got his first shahada at school. Yeah, you know, brothers and sisters, you have to bring up your children properly. Really. You have to bring up your children with a proactive mentality. You have to bring them up to be du'at. No one is born, as I always say, I wasn't born. Yeah, I wasn't born going in alhamdulillah nahmaduhu wa nasta'inuhu wa nastaghfiruh. That's not how it happened. You know, it takes time and effort and energy and learning and studying and doing it to learn how to give da'wah. As parents, we have to give our children that tarbiyah or that training for our children is very, very important. And also we need to show them and lead by example. So please, brothers and sisters, this is important as parents. So alhamdulillah, yes, it's fantastic, 16-year-old and enthusiastic and worried about their commitment is a very good thing, inshaAllah. Jazakallah khair.
Jazakallah khair. Our next question is for Sheikh Muhammad Salah. I am a practicing Muslim, however, I possess homosexual desire. Since I was young, many Muslims I know have succumbed to these temptations, believe me. My question, why has Allah created me naturally this way if it is doomed to be sinful, and how do I address this weakness? And I think, Sheikh, this is also another related question as well. We know of somebody actually within this conference who actually changed their gender from a male to a female. And since then, that person has donned a hijab and so on and so forth. So what is your advice in these kind of situations?
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I definitely believe this is the most important question that we had tonight. And we have to face challenges like that bravely and confront the reality. As the questioner presented the question, this is something that nowadays is spreading, not only among Allah subhanahu. And don't you go near zina. Don't you go near adultery. There is not a single ayah in the Quran, ya Shaykh, that says do not commit adultery. There is not a single ayah in the Quran that says do not drink. Rather, it says, اجتنبو, avoid it. Do not go near it. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put Adam and Eve in heaven, He allowed them to enjoy everything in paradise except one tree. He said concerning the tree, لا تقرب هذه الشجرة. Don't you go near the tree. I would like to tell you that the tendency that has been developed in your mind, you were not born with it. Rather, it has been developed as a result of surfing these pornographic websites and watching these evil movies. And gradually you built up this habit of watching the haram so that the halal would not satisfy you. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لا تقربوا الزنا, He said, لا تقربوا الزنا, do not go near it. And He prescribed means to block the means which may lead to zina. He said in ayah number 30 and also in 31 of Surah An-Nur, قل للمؤمنين يغضوا من أبصارهم ويحفظوا فروجهم. Command the believing men to lower some of their gaze, not all their gaze, because you have to look at what is halal. Okay? But lower their gaze from looking at what Allah has forbidden. This is how Allah blocked the means of leading to zina. He said also in the following ayah, وَقُلْ لِلْمُؤْمِنَاتِ يَغْضُضْنَ مِنْ أَبْصَارِهِنْ. Likewise, to lower some of their gaze. When the person allows himself to look, then look again, then look for hours, then become convinced with the haram idea, and he becomes saturated with the ma'asiyah, he ends up, as you just said, he becomes possessed, not possessed with the jinn, possessed with the ma'asiyah. Ibn al-Qayyim, may Allah have mercy on him, said, dafi' al-khatirah, dafi' al-fikrah, number one, if there is an evil idea that crosses your mind, word it off. Stop it right there. Because if you start thinking about it, it becomes a khatira. You contemplate it. Then you enjoy it, the next step. Then you cannot go to sleep before thinking about it over and over. And it even crosses your mind within the prayer, in the sujood. Whenever you're supposed to be the closest to Allah, you are thinking about the sexual positions and the sexual clips that you have been addicted to watch in the salah. A medical student met me after the Fajr prayer and said, Sheikh, I failed to concentrate and I used to be very good. I'm not studying very well. I'm not doing good in school and I cannot memorize Quran. I find it hard to read Quran. So he asked me the question in front of people. So I brought him near to me and I whispered in his ear, do you watch pornographic materials? He said, occasionally, like on the weekend. I said, that's why. What is happening to you because of that? You're not born with this desire, brothers and sisters. You're born pure. كل مولود يولد على الفطرة. And the pure instinct is entirely against that. لوط عليه السلام said to his people, أتأتون الفاحشة ما سبقكم بها أحد من العالمين. You've come with a fahisha, an illicit act. No one before you have ever did it. People are not born like that. They're not created like that. Now we are at a position where you say that you developed this desire and it is within you. What can you do? By the end of Surah Al-Baqarah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لِلَّهِ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ وَإِنْ تُبِدُوا مَا فِي أَنفُسِكُمْ أَوْ تُخْفُوهُ يُحَاسِبِكُمْ بِهِ اللَّهِ. Whatever you conceal, if there is something in your heart, in your mind that you're thinking about it, whether you conceal it or you show it, you expose it, reveal it, Allah will definitely hold you accountable for it. So even your mere thoughts, daydreams, you'll be held accountable for it. The companions fell on their knees and they said, Ya Rasulullah, we cannot afford it. Because we do think about bad things, we're human beings. He said, do not object to Allah similar to what the Yahud did. Rather you should say, سَمِعْنَا وَأَطَعْنَا. So they complied and they said, سَمِعْنَا وَأَطَعْنَا. We heard and we obeyed. Immediately Allah the Almighty revealed the relief. The following ayah says, لَهَا مَا كَسَبَتْ وَعَلَيْهَا مَا اكْتَسَبَتْ. The ayah says what? لَا يُكَلِّفُ اللَّهُ نَفْسًا إِلَّا وُسْعَهَا. Allah does not lay any takalif or impose any commands on any soul beyond its capacity. The person will be only held accountable for what he or she did, the good for good and the bad for bad. So the relief was relieved. Revealed to announce that if it is only mere thoughts and you resist it and you dismiss it, in ayah number 36 of Surah Fussilat, and similarly in ayah number 200 of Surah At-Tawbah, with a little bit of different ending, in Surah Fussilat, Allah the Almighty says, وَإِمَّا يَنْزَغَنَّكَ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ نَزْغٌ فَاسْتَعِذْ بِاللَّهِ إِنَّهُ هُوَ السَّمِيعُ الْعَلِيمُ. In Surah Fussilat 200 At-Tawbah, إِنَّهُ سَمِيعٌ عَلِيمٌ. What does it mean? Whenever the shaitan whispers to you with an evil thought, cut it off. Cut it short. Do not even think about it. Do not give the shaitan the opportunity to plant the seed of evil and incite you to bring your thoughts into action. Simply by saying, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. So seek therapy. Resort to the Quran. Sit with a sheikh. Make a schedule of certain religious activities to do in order to overcome this thought. You're not born homosexual. Rather, it is something that has been developed in your mind as a result of a factor or another. I'm talking to the questioner. So if you involve yourself with the right activities, istighfar, salah, and dua, asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to cure you, because it's a, you know, if you feel yourself having this problem, resort to Allah. Ask Allah to help you, to eliminate the thought from your mind, and Allah will help you. This man, Ya Shaykh Abdul Rahim, walked in young man to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and said, Ya Rasulullah, allow me to commit adultery. I'm willing to pray, to fast, and do everything. Only one thing that I cannot quit. I love to commit adultery. The companions were ready to chop off his head. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Udnu, come close. I paid close attention to this man because he has a serious problem. He did not say, how could you say that in public, yo? No, he said, come. Then he addressed him logically. He said, أَتَرْضَهُ لِأُمِّكَ. Would he agree that your mother would commit adultery? He said, no. لِأُخْتِكَ, your sister. لِخَالَتِكَ, لِعَمَّتِكَ, your aunt. Maternal or paternal, he said, no. He said, similarly, people would not like to see their mothers, their sisters, their daughters, or their aunts involved in zina. Then look at the power of dua. He said, Udno, come close. Then he placed his right palm upon his heart. And he said, Allahumma ghfir dhanbah, wahfaz farjah, wa tahhir qalbah. Make this dua in your prayer. He said, Oh Allah, forgive him his sin, purify his heart, and guard his chastity, guard his private part. After the Prophet ﷺ made this dua to him, the man turned around to say, Wallahi, nothing has become more hated to my heart than adultery. It is the power of dua. So now I'm generalizing the answer, not only to limit my answer to a specific case. You know, many of us, ordinary human beings, have tendency and sexual desires towards the opposite gender. Look at this. Once the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was walking in the street, and his eyes were laid upon a woman by accident. He turned around and he went home. Then he had an intimate relationship with his spouse. Then he addressed the companions. If any of you happen to see a woman who attracted him, let him go to his wife and satisfy his desire, because she's got the same, and that will suppress this evil desire. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam does not treat a problem superficially by saying, haram, do not look, and that's it. Rather, he approaches the problem. O young men, if you can afford to get married, let whoever can afford to get married, get married. So get married. Hopefully, inshallah, that will make you overcome this desire, which again, I confirm, you were not born with it. According to our understanding from the Quran and the Sahih Sunnah, كُلُّ مَوْلُودٍ يُولَدُ عَلَى الْفِطْرَةِ أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم.
جزاك الله خير شيخ. Just a follow-up question about the transgender individual. I mean, that person has repented, started praying, and because she, that person changed gender to a female, like, shall that person continue to wear hijab and don a lifestyle as a sister in Islam? And why wear hijab?
You see, Islam actually addressed this issue, and the fuqaha addressed whether the person was born with both sexual private parts. Like, for instance, a hermaphrodite. It's a medical term. Okay? So the fuqaha determined based on the medical condition, whichever gender the person is closer to, it is permissible to stick to the gender and to do the medical surgeries needed in order to maintain what actually overcome his personality. But if a person is born as a full male, then willingly he chose to change his gender as something Islam disapproves. Imagine, or if it is the opposite, why? We have a hadith in which the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, لَعَنَ اللَّهُ الْمُتَرَجِّلَةَ مِنَ النِّسَاءِ اللَّهُ أَكْبَرُ. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Allah curses a woman who dresses up like a man, just dresses up like a man. And also a man who dresses up like a woman. Cross-dressing is haram in Islam. Only cross-dressing, you know. And these issues, if you find these symptoms, and you find the early markers, you better consult somebody whom you trust and be open with them so that you see the proper solution. And of course, there are things not to be discussed in public. But if you come to the Sheikh, and it happens with us all the time, yani, not only with regards to this matter, it's very rare, alhamdulillah. I cannot say it's a phenomenon. It's very rare. But I'm talking about other matters such as being addicted to watching bad things, having a girlfriend or a boyfriend. So trying to befriend the Sheikh or the Imam or a consultant would definitely help you. People pay thousands and thousands to visit psychiatrists and psychologists who charge nothing. At least you may benefit from the dua. You know, when the brother said, one sister, Australian sister, is asking us to make dua for her mother. I innocently raised my hands. I didn't wait that we make collective dua. Why? Because you never know. Everyone make dua on your own. She's very smart. Imagine 3,000 people, 4,000 people. I'm pretty sure one of us, his or her dua will be accepted. You know? So make plenty of dua, especially in the position of sujood.
Ameen, inshallah. Okay, our next question. I had a question to ask, but it's not related to the topic. It's regarding shaving the beard, because my father keep forcing me to shave the beard. When I surfed the internet, I didn't find a satisfactory answer. Please don't ignore my question. Okay. So this question is for Sheikh Ismail Menk.
Jazakallah khair. Although Sheikh Abdurrahim has a bigger beard than mine, but I will take this, inshallah. Barakallah fi. The Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, Sheikh, do you want to measure, Sheikh? Volume is just got to do with the shampoo, ya akhi. Okay. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has instructed us to grow our beards and shorten the mustache. So the mustache needs to be shortened and the beard needs to be lengthened. It needs to be grown. So a mu'min's identity, part of a masculine identity, is that he has a beard. So inshallah, if your parent is instructing you to shave, then they're instructing you to do something which is against the sunnah of Rasulullah ﷺ, the teachings of Islam and the teaching of Rasulullah ﷺ. So perhaps you'd like to address the issue with your parent to explain to them that I need to have a beard and I need to grow it. Even if it means you start off with just a little bit. I remember there was a young man many years back who didn't have a beard, and I spoke to him and I told him, every time you shave, leave one hair. And he looked at me and he started laughing. I said, and then you leave one hair on either side. And I said, one day you'll have a goatee. You know what's a goatee? A goatee is a little, they call it a saksuk. You know, it's a little small little beard here, just on the chin. So I met him a few years later and he had a very nice healthy beard, you know, alhamdulillah. So he told me something that, okay, and then mashallah, from there I found out what happened, and he said, I started growing my beard, and alhamdulillah, initially it was growing one side, not growing the other side, and developing all sorts of excuses, and now it's been a while, I let it just grow, and I'm so happy that it's, you know, this beard has grown of mine. So subhanAllah, it just requires the willpower. Start off with something small, and soon inshallah you'll have something healthy. You know, you look masculine, so you look like a male, subhanAllah. You don't look like a female. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala strengthen us. I would definitely love to die in a condition where my face is not going to embarrass me. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make that happen for us all. Wallahu a'lam.
Ameen. Actually, I heard a quote, Sheikh. If you shave a beard from a lion, what do you get?
If you shave a beard from a lion?
What do you get?
You get a lioness, mashallah.
Actually, you can try this, Photoshop this for yourself, remove the beard from the lion.
But you will never be able to shave the beard of a lion, because that lion will bite you before you can do that, mashallah.
Okay, jazakallah khair, Sheikh.
One quick point whilst we just a second. I just love when I sit with colleagues who are just so beloved to me. So we have such a beautiful relationship, and I like this. I will never ever, and this is something I want to share with everyone, I will never ever belittle someone who's calling towards Allah, not in the least, no matter who. And this is why I make it a point to reach out to those who are doing good work of calling people towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and those who share, you know, a similar, or who are on the same wavelength, so to speak. Oh, we just love them. You know, mashallah, it's the first time I'm meeting Sheikh Abdurrahim Green, by the way. And mashallah, I had to get up and get around my table to give him a big hug, to say, whoa, finally meet the man, mashallah. So it's always so good. And I am saying this because we have love between us, even as people who call towards the deen. And it's good for you to feel it, because you know we are all part of the same ummah calling towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Can I add one more thing? We love you all as well, mashallah. Barakallah fi.
May the one whose sake you love us for also love you in return. Ameen. There's one last question, and I believe this is quite relevant. Just a final one for Sheikh Muhammad Salam. Salam, can qadr be changed? If Allah has already written for me to enter the hellfire, can that be changed?
How do you know that Allah has written for you to enter hellfire? I love Imam Abu Hanifa, may Allah have mercy on him. You know, the question about shaving the lion beard and so on. Whenever some people, philosophers and the people of the Kalam, would come and ask him questions, you know, hypothetical questions. He said, did it happen? He
say, no, yeah, but I'm just saying in case. I say, when it happens, inshallah, we'll make ijtihad for it. Have you already known that Allah has decreed your name to enter hellfire? No, you haven't. Nor have you known that your name is mentioned to be amongst Ahlul Jannah. So what you need to do? كُلُّ مُيَسَّرٌ لُمَّا خُلِقَ لَهُ اعْمَلُوا. Just work and work hard. You will find it easy to find your fate. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is only asking from you to work. To work to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Stop asking questions about, you know, I feel like my qadr is this and this. No, you don't feel it. You don't know it because it is entirely unknown to you. Absolutely. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the last ayah of Surah Luqman, إِنَّ اللَّهَ عِنْدَهُ عِلْمُ السَّاعَةِ وَيُنَزِّلُ الْغَيْثِ وَيَعْلَمُ مَا فِي الْأَرْحَامِ وَمَا تَدْرِي نَفْسٌ مَاذَا تَكْسِبُ غَدَى وَمَا تَدْرِي نَفْسٌ بِأَيِّ أَرْضٍ تَمُوتُ. Five knowledges of the unseen that none knows them but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There is a man, do you guys know that there is one person who at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam died and entered paradise even though he did not pray a single sajda. He did not pray a single rak'ah. Have you heard of this man before? Huh? Do you know his name? For those who say yes. It's Al-Usayrim. The last one of a tribe from Al-Ansar, Al-Khazraj, he basically refused to accept Islam entirely. Then on the battle of Uhud, they found him. He was injured badly and he was in his last breath. Somebody asked him, have you come out of prejudice to defend your people? He said, no, I just accepted Islam. So he informed the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said, this man has entered paradise already. And he did not even make ghusl. He did not say the shahada before no one. He said it before himself and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So how do you know that? Subhanallah, in the hadith of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, in أَحَدَكُمْ يُجْمَعُ خَلْقُهُ فِي بَطْنِ أُمِّهِ. It's a long hadith about the process of the creation and embryology and so on. Then he by the end says that a man may work according to the deeds and the work of Ahlul Jannah until there is nothing left between him and an-nar but an arm about Al-Jannah to enter it but an arm's length. Then he changes and he ends up in the other destination. And on the other hand, somebody who's been very wicked, all his deeds are according to the deeds and the work of Ahlul Nar. Until there is nothing left between him and entering far, the far of hell, but an arm's length. حَتَّى مَا يَكُونُ بَيْنَهُ وَبَيْنَهَا إِلَّا ذِرَاعٌ فَيَسْبِقُ عَلَيْهِ الْكِتَابُ فَيَعْمَلُ بِعَمَلِ أَهْلِ الْجَنَّةِ فَيَدْخُلَهَا. It changes according to Allah's qadr. He repents. And in this few centimeters left before entering Al-Jannah, few moments in his life, that he changes, he repents, and he dies in this condition. And he becomes from amongst the dwellers of paradise. Which keeps us always in a state of hope and fear. Hoping that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will cause us to die as Muslims and in good conditions. And fear that we may change, so we constantly ask him, Ya muqallib al-qulub, Ya muqallib al-qulub, ثبت قلوبنا على دينك. Oh Allah, the one who changes the hearts, keep our hearts firm on your religion.
JazakAllah khair, Sheikh. Okay, time check. We have 5 minutes before Maghrib. And just before we wrap up, we'd like to give 1 minute. 1 minute faqab, for each speaker, just to give some closing remarks before we close our session on this beautiful weekend, inshallah. So we'll start with Sheikh Ismail, inshallah.
Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. My brothers and sisters, we are definitely going to be asked about this on the Day of Judgment. We will definitely be asked about this and the meeting we've had and what we've said and the resolutions we've made and how our lives have changed thereafter. So please take it seriously. And as much as we've tried to keep it as light as possible, sharing a few jokes, making us laugh, that's just a way of getting the message across. But the message itself is very, very serious. And what we need to know is please make an effort to go to get closer to Allah. Pray for us as well. The message is for all of us. We are also part and parcel of those who are required to improve. So I hope and I pray that inshallah you will take this very seriously, and it will not just have been a waste of 2 days by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Also, I ask you to forgive any shortcomings that may have come, not only on my part, but on the part of any one of the organizers or the speakers, anything that may have been said that might have been offensive or something that might have been done. we need to learn to overlook things, we need to learn to understand the broader picture, and that people didn't, everyone tried to make things easy for us all, but sometimes, like I said at the beginning of my talk this evening, it's a test from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we need to know the difference between the tests of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So jazakumullah khair, and I hope to see you soon again by the will of Allah. Jazakumullah khair.
Okay, Sheikh Abdurrahim.
It's been very nice coming back to Malaysia. I had nasi lemak again for breakfast today. Alhamdulillah, mashallah. It's been a real pleasure being able to talk to you. The atmosphere has been fantastic. You even laughed at some of my jokes. And you even laughed at some things that were not supposed to be jokes. So that was nice as well. Alhamdulillah. But inshallah, it's been a real pleasure. Jazakallah khair, brothers and sisters. Just to reiterate what the Sheikh said, and to reinforce the importance of acting on what you have learned. And I really loved what he said about, you know, the 48-hour window. You know, if you don't act within 48 hours, you're probably not going to act. So subhanAllah, that got me thinking a lot as well, mashaAllah. And a big jazakallah khair to all the organizers and the volunteers. You know, you don't, if you haven't thanked the creation, you didn't thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, you know, they have done so much work, have put so much effort into it. And, you know, may Allah bless them. May Allah write it in their book of good deeds. And everybody for coming here as well. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala write it, all of you, in your book of good deeds. And jazakallah khair for inviting me and being here as well, and listening to what I have to say and letting me share my small little insights and teachy bit of knowledge with you. It's been a real pleasure. Jazakallah khair.
Subhanallah, it's always a problem for the last speaker, because, you know, everything that he's planning to speak about, you know, the earlier speakers would cover. It's like, you know, you just said whatever I wanted to say. But subhanallah, when Ibrahim alayhi salam and his son Ismail were entrusted with the task of building the Kaaba, Allah recorded in the Quran their most important invocation. وَإِذْ يَرْفَعُ إِبْرَهِيمُ رَبَّنَا تَقَبَّلْ مِنَّا إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ السَّمِيعُ الْعَلِيمُ. Our Lord, accept from us. You are indeed the all-hearer, the all-knowing. Abdullah ibn Umar ibn Khattab radiyallahu anhuma said, have I known for sure that Allah have accepted from me one single sajda? I would love to die right now. They said, and why single sajda? He said, because Allah says in Surah Al-Ma'idah, إِنَّمَا يَتَقَبَّلُ اللَّهُ مِنَ الْمُتَّقِينَ. Allah only accepts from the righteous ones. So if he accepted anything from me, I'm already labeled as righteous. Then I don't mind to die right now. Imagine how many good words, how many ayat, how many ahadith, how many words of advices, how many good feelings we share together, we pray jama'ah together, we ate together, we prayed for each other. We're just waiting on one thing. Al-qabool. تَقَبَّلَ اللَّهُ مِنَّا مِنْكُمْ. May Allah accept from all of us. And they say in Urdu, Allah kabul kai. تَقَبَّلَ اللَّهُ مِنَّا مِنْكُمْ وَصَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَىٰ سَيِّدَنَا مُحَمَّدٍ وَعَلَىٰ آلِهِ وَصَحْبِهِ وَسَلَّمْ وَجَزَاكُمُ اللَّهُ خَيْرًا. We all love you all for the sake of Allah. Thank you all, and thanks, great thanks to the organizers and the volunteers. May Allah accept from all of us. وَالسَّلَامُ عَلَيْكُمْ ورحمة الله وبركاته.
وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته. جزاكم الله خير. All the speakers and all the organizers.